was already a very large high tide, as well as the storm surge coming in with the wind and the tide lining up perfectly to give us 14-foot tides instead of 8-foot.
The most shocking part of Hurricane Sandy was the fact thank you.
Dear fellow students, speakers, and partners, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 6th annual Aarhus Symposium. My name is Camilla, and this is Line, and together we are the steering committee of Aarhus Symposium 2016. This year, Aarhus Symposium sheds light on the theme, the art of power. To prepare you for today's inspiring talks and discussions, we would like to share with you a short video.
When you hear the word power, many of you may think of hierarchies, military forces, dictatorship. But isn't power about seeking opportunities? In the world of business, skillful leaders utilize these opportunities, even when challenged by the unpredictable. Established companies face challenges as new actors enter the market and redefine the status quo. Those who rest on their laurels will quickly lose their position, especially in this digital age. But even the most powerful companies may find themselves powerless on a global scale. When companies operate across borders, new challenges arise. Imagine how international political conflicts or humanitarian crises may suddenly affect your business strategy. Competent leadership is a crucial advantage in solving these challenges. A skillful leader recognizes and understands the cultural norms that differ across countries when putting power into practice. Some even manage to generate their own powerful position as they hold courage and a strong personality. Whether power is associated with limitations or opportunities thus depends on the leader's abilities. The theme of Aarhus Symposium 2016 is The Art of Power.
We hope that the video leaves you with a lot of curiosity and interesting questions. To mark the beginning of today's program, we have invited one of the most powerful individuals in Denmark. He will present his view on this year's theme. Please help me welcome on stage the Prime Minister of Denmark, Lars Løkke Rasmussen.
Thank you for the warm welcome and thank you for inviting me to deliver the opening speech. I consider myself lucky to get the opportunity to be here today and meet with the leaders of tomorrow, being someone who is, no, I'm not the leader of yesterday, I'm the leader of today, but you are the leaders of tomorrow. And I feel privilege to be here, and I think you should consider you lucky as well. Not because you are listening to me, but because you got a ticket for Aarhus Symposium. I'm told they were sold out in like 3 minutes. The theme this year is, as we just witnessed, the art of power. And the speakers list is impressive: presidents, CEOs, founders, directors, you name it. Prior to today, I took a look at your website for Aarhus Symposium, and I stumbled across a quote regarding the art of power. It said, "Leaders who successfully manage the art can accomplish extraordinary things. Leaders who do not will stumble and miss great opportunities." I hope that is not true. Because if leadership is measured by the absence of stumbling, there wouldn't be many good leaders left, if any, and I can assure you that I wouldn't be invited. And I don't think it's true either. In fact, I think it is the other way around. Leaders who haven't tried to stumble can hardly be said to master the art of power. And I'm not just saying that because I'm leader of a very small minority government. I honestly think that stumbling shows that you are trying to achieve high goals. If stumbling makes you wiser. You shouldn't be afraid to fall. That goes for leaders in both private companies, public institutions, and in politics. And it goes for the leaders of tomorrow as well. Or, as they say in Korea, from which I returned only a few days ago, even a monkey can fall from a tree. Now, speaking of the art of power, it is tempting to start by quoting everyone from Machiavelli to Mark Zuckerberg, but I won't do that. Instead, I will tell you who has formed my own view on political power, N.F.S. Grundtvig. And why him? Well, because Grundtvig, one of the most important things about power, he said, it is its limitation. Limitation of the power of the state in order to secure the individual freedom of speech, freedom to pursue happiness, freedom to evolve as a human being. And to me, the true art of power is to empower. To empower my own children to take a stand, to empower the boys in the Lykke Foundation who is on the edge of the society to stand up and realize that this society actually gives them a lot of opportunities, to empower you to become excellent students, to empower everyone to fulfill their potential. And this is not only my vision, or Grundtvig's vision for that matter. It has been a fundamental source of Danish democracy for centuries. 200 years ago, we introduced compulsory school attendance because we wanted to empower the children of that time. And 100 years ago, a persistent group of women and some men fought for women's right to vote because they wanted to empower women with the same fundamental rights as men. And today, here in Aarhus, we are gathered at a top-class university, free of charge and full of opportunities, because Denmark wants to empower you to fulfill your dreams. And this tradition of empowerment on any level is, I think, a distinctive Danish value, and to me, its importance can't be overstated. In fact, it has been the guiding principle to me as a politician and as a leader and as a father. And this is also the reason why I, 15 years ago, proposed to grant each patient in this country the power to choose a private hospital if the public hospital couldn't deliver. It was, in these days, those days, somewhat controversial, to say the least. But to me, it was evident. Empowering the patient with the freedom to choose is not only prudent, it is basically the only decent thing to do. And today, empowerment of patients is an integrated part of the Danish healthcare system. We make the money follow the patient, so that if public healthcare can't deliver the diagnosing or treatment we expect for them within a reasonable time frame, then the patients are empowered to go somewhere else. And the same principle of empowerment goes for our wish to liberalize the current Plan Act, or in Danish Plan Law. For many years, politicians in Copenhagen and powerful interest groups have seemed to think that they know what is best for the citizens in the rural districts. Well, having served as a city councillor and a county mayor for many years, I can only say they don't. Local empowerment and democracy are essential to local development because it provides people with the incentive to act, to get involved, to take matters into their own hands, and to make a difference. And that is important, this feeling of taking things into your own hands and to make a true difference is important at any level and almost any cases. We need to empower each other to do our best. All that said, when empowered to make decisions, you are morally obliged to act responsibly. And that goes for politicians, and that goes for CEOs and headmasters and teachers and students. And this might seem obvious, but it is not. Neither historically nor at present. In these years, we witness powerful populist movements and individuals gaining ground in many parts of Europe and across the Atlantic, for that matters. Or on the far left and on the far right. Movements and persons who claiming to be the only ones representing the people, fighting for justice, fighting for jobs, fighting for the man on the floor. And these movements vary in their outset, but they have something in common. They fail to take responsibility. Why? Because they most often only point out the problems, but fail to come up with coherent and lasting solutions. And in a complex world, and definitely we are living in a complex world, we must not allow ourselves to be tempted by simplistic solutions, because simplistic solutions, they are always too simple. This is to some extent also the case when it comes to the European Union. In these years, we witness widespread skepticism towards the EU in many, many member states. In Denmark, and the British have even decided to leave the Union without having any clear idea of what they want instead. And you could ask why. Because they feel that the European Union has too many flaws and deficiencies, not working as it should. And to some extent, of course, I can understand the feeling, and I guess we all can understand that feeling. But what is the solution? Well, the irresponsible solution is to turn the back on the community, regardless of the consequences and without any clear idea of what to do instead. In contrast, the responsible solution is to start making things work, come up with realistic solutions instead of just pointing fingers. And this has been my fundamental approach to power and politics since the day I was elected chairman of the Young Liberals 30 years ago in 1986, and it still is. In my mind, powerful movements, persons, and parties are morally obliged to present realistic, transparent, and coherent solutions in order to empower people to take an enlightened stand. And this leads me to my final point, which is in fact more of a reminder, not at least to you, the leaders of tomorrow. We Danes are a modest people, and perhaps sometimes too modest. But we don't actually need to be. We have developed a very well-functioning society. It's not the perfect society, but we are one of the happiest, richest, most stable, competitive, and innovative countries in the world. And I was reaffirmed by this on my recent state visits in Korea. They are profoundly impressed and inspired by our small country. For instance, they have just opened a continuation school outside Seoul in the spirit of Grundtvig, because they can see the value of our broad societal approach to education. And I must admit that it warms my heart, and it makes me proud, and it inspires me to keep fighting for an even better future. And I hope the same goes for you, the leaders of tomorrow. You shouldn't be too modest. You should be proud of yourself. Don't be afraid to strive for influence. Seize the day, seize the power to make Denmark and the world a better place. But when you have seized it, remember that along with power and opportunities comes responsibility. And be aware that the true art of power is to empower your surroundings to fulfill their potential. I wish you all a good and inspiring symposium. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lars Løkke Rasmussen, for kicking off our symposium 2016. Please accept this gift, as we are truly honored by your contribution as our opening speaker. Thank you.
Thank you.
Before we begin, I will kindly ask track one to head to the Jyske Bank Auditorium and track two to head to the TDC Group Auditorium, where your sessions will begin shortly. Track three and four, remain seated. So, while track one and two leave the auditorium, I have a few practical announcements. Today's sessions begin with a personal presentation by the speakers, followed by a Q&A session. You can ask the speakers your questions in two ways. First, you can simply raise your hand and an organizer will bring you a microphone. And secondly, you can access our online Q&A tool, Slido, on your smartphones. Go to slido.com and enter our event code, ASIMP2016. Remember throughout the day to choose the correct auditorium. We strongly encourage you to actively participate in our Q&A sessions and really challenge the speakers with any questions you might have. Furthermore, we have exciting prizes for the winners of today's two competitions: Best Question Asked on Slido and Best Picture Posted on Instagram using our hashtag ASIMP2016. So, without further ado, let me welcome on stage the moderator of our first session and a good friend of our symposium, journalist and anchor at TV2 Business, Vibeke Dahl Bjerrum.
Tak, lige måde. Hello everyone, and thank you very much for having me back. It's my third year here at the Aarhus Symposium, and I always enjoy it a lot, mainly because it's very easy for me, because you guys always ask the best questions. So I would like to encourage you to do the same this year. Go to Slido, or even better, stand up and ask your questions when we reach the Q&A session, because that's always the most interesting part about the sessions, when you challenge and test the speakers. And I mean, you ask a lot of the questions that we anchors don't dare to ask. So go right ahead, let's go get them. I also like the theme of this year, power, the art of power. We often discuss this at TV2 Business: what is power? Who's the most powerful businessman in Denmark right now? And I was actually a bit surprised about this speaker, because I hadn't considered power in this way. But when I thought about it, I mean, it's obvious that you would put Bjarke Ingels on this power list. I read somewhere that he is architect famous, meaning that maybe you wouldn't recognize him on the street, but you would be able to point out one of his buildings or something he made. I actually disagree. I think that in Denmark he's pretty famous, and you would recognize him on the street, because we're so proud of him here in Denmark to have a countryman who's done so well for himself. But he's also famous abroad. He's He's 42 years old, and he already turned his business from zero to 250 employees. He's made several great landmarks already. He's currently building the new Google headquarters, Googleplex. He's building the last of the new World Trade Centers. And he also made his first skyscraper, which I guess for an architect must be somewhat of a special turning point in a career, I would guess so. But it seems that he's not done reaching for the sky yet. He has a lot of big projects coming up. And actually, Rolling Stones magazine just wrote about him recently, and I think they put it really well, because they said, Bjarke Ingels, the man building the future. I mean, come on, that's pretty powerful. So with that, I think we should just please welcome Bjarke Ingels to the stage.
Thank you. It's a great pleasure to be here in Aarhus, and it is very true, because I mean since I am an architect and since you don't typically associate architects with power, I would say like you probably more likely associate architects with powerlessness. I was thinking about like how I could make myself relevant in this room, and I think maybe you can say, you know, as architects we might not have the political power because we can't decide what needs to get done, and anyone who's ever followed any public debate about architecture can see that the things often get voted down and they end up not happening. So we don't have political power. We don't have financial power either, because we can't pay for the things we do, like the skyscraper that we just completed in New York is worth several billion kroner, and that's not the kind of change we walk around with. So we don't have financial power. But I think what we do have is that we have the power of our ideas, that. We have the potential to put forward ideas that can somehow be the answer to the questions or the needs that the people walk around with, and with those examples we can actually make a meaningful difference. So I'd like to talk with you about an idea we've been developing in our office over the last decade. Our office is called the BIG, Bjarke Ingels Group. I have very committed colleagues, and this is our workspace. It's a former Carlsberg factory, and I think it's kind of relevant, because I mean there's something interesting that quite often you see that, you know, the most successful museum in London is a former power plant, the most successful park in New York are former train tracks, the High Line. And some of the best workspaces are former factories that have been converted, because they're not tailored for the purpose they have. They have a certain generosity. They have big spans for maximum freedom, tall ceiling height so you can move big stuff around, like abundance of daylight, because daylight is cheaper than electricity. So in that sense, they have some kind of infrastructural raw attributes that can then suddenly become the perfect framework for a creative office. And that leads me to this idea that we've been developing that we call social infrastructure, which is like a term originally sort of coined, let's say, in the 60s, often referring to the social network in a community, the amount of kindergartens and nursery homes and medical centers. But we mean it much more literally. Infrastructural projects, raw pieces of public utility that have positive social and environmental side effects. And we all know that a piece of infrastructure like a bridge or a highway can have a negative impact on its community. We were asked to look at downtown Vancouver, where Granville Bridge touches downtown, and where people, it's like, it's really the center of the city, but except here, because the trifork of the bridge had torn this city block to pieces, And we were asked to see if we could turn that into a successful neighborhood. So we started looking at the constraints. There was like some setbacks from the streets. There was a setback that you were not allowed to build closer to touch the bridge. Actually, you were not allowed to even build as close as 30 meters to the bridge because the city wants to make sure that nobody looks into the traffic on the bridge. Then there's a park where we can't cast any shadows. And finally, we're left with a tiny footprint of 600 square meters, almost too small to build. But then we thought, if the distance to the bridge has to do with a minimum distance from the home to the car, once we get 30 meters up in the air, we can actually grow the building back, make it twice as big. As you drive over the bridge, it feels as if someone is pulling a curtain aside, sort of welcome to Vancouver. Or imagine like a weed growing through the cracks in the pavement, and then it starts to blossom when it gets air and daylight. And then we try to turn the, you know, because like between the bridges, we can actually put shops, offices, and spaces for work. And we try to turn the underside of the bridge into a positive. So we worked with a local group of artists from Vancouver, including Rodney Graham, to turn the underside of the bridge into what we've called the Sistine's Chapel of Street Art. Essentially an art gallery turned upside down. And suddenly you'll find that what used to be the negative impact of the bridge is now becoming the character and the soul of this new neighborhood in Vancouver. Also, we all know that just like the Tate Modern, a piece of infrastructure from the past can get reinvented as a piece of culture. We did the Danish Maritime Museum next to Hamlet's castle, Kronborg. Kronborg became a UNESCO World Heritage. So the Maritime Museum used to be inside the castle. They had to kick it out. And they suggested, why don't you put it in the dry dock where they used to build the ships? And there was some kind of a dilemma because we weren't allowed to stick as much as a centimeter out of the ground to not block the view of the castle. So we got the idea to, in a way, turn the dock inside out, to use the museum to preserve the dock. All we had to do was design three bridges, one that connects, like stops the water from coming in, one that connects to the castle. And then, because we couldn't even put an elevator, there's a bridge that actually gently slopes down and takes you into the museum. Then you have this like journey through different kinds of spaces. The architecture is very much the encounter between the lightness of the glass and the steel and the heritage and the heaviness of the concrete. You have an auditorium where the seats for the grown-ups continue under the stage and becomes an auditorium for children. You have the restaurant where you look through different layers of transparency. And not only the inside is now part of the cultural environment of Helsingør, also the dock itself has become like a great venue for acoustic music because you have the heavy walls and the instant reverberation and the open sky. So suddenly like this like piece of decommissioned infrastructure is now part of the heart of the cultural life of Helsingør. I love this image. It's almost like a diagram that you have, you know, above the horizon, the heritage, and below the horizon, the contemporary life of the city. This is the sort of inverse Titanic moment. So working with the Maritime Museum, we started looking a lot into the maritime infrastructure, and like one of the main sort of logistical infrastructures of our society is the infrastructure of shipping logistics. And we found out that you can buy this. It's a 45-foot high cube container. It's roughly 3 meters tall, almost 15 meters long. And it cost 2,000 euros in Rotterdam. At this point, it will have sailed a few times around the Earth, but it's perfectly strong. You can stack them 8 levels. So we got the idea that maybe we could hijack the infrastructure of global shipping. If we have 9 of them, we have 300 square meters of space. If we stack them up to 7 meters tall, just in 2 layers, on a barge, we can actually build them within the maritime regulations. so we can actually turn these 9 containers into the home for 12 students. Each of them get like roughly 25 square meters of space. They have a shared roof deck, they have a green roof, and they have a photovoltaic roof where 4 of the solar panels run a heat pump in the floating element underneath it that extracts the heat from the sea and actually heats the entire 12 homes and all their hot water for free. Basically, we built it in a shipyard in Poland. We dragged it across the Baltic Sea. It arrived by boat early morning in Copenhagen. And essentially, for around 5,000 kroner, you can get a waterfront piece of property, 5,000 kroner per month. You can have probably the coolest house you'll ever have in your entire life as a student, looking straight over the water. You can you practically have free food, because if you have a fishing rod, you can just stick it out the window. Also, the water is so clean that you can jump out the window into the port of Copenhagen and climb back in. So essentially, almost like taking this whole industry that comes from the efficiency of global logistics and actually use those efficiencies to become the solution to the fact that you have a severe undersupply of student housing in practically all university cities in Western Europe. Also, a project that I think really captures the essence of social infrastructure is a building we are finishing right now in Copenhagen that I think could become the landmark of Copenhagen in the future. And it's not a cultural palace. It's neither the opera nor the Royal Theatre nor the Royal Palace. It's a power plant that turns household waste into electricity and district heating. Because these kind of waste-to-energy power plants, they work on an economy of scale. They have to be very, very large facilities. This is going to be the tallest and biggest building in Copenhagen. And we thought it's going to be right next to the marina. It's going to replace the power plant you see in the background, right next to the Copenhagen Cable Park, where the locals go water skiing. And we thought, like, how can we make this in such a way that it doesn't just become like another ugly box that like blocks the views and casts shadows on the neighbors? And we didn't just want to make it a cosmetic exercise to make the power plant look pretty, but rather, like, how could it really be materially different? And we got inspired by the water skiers, because as you probably know, Danes, we love to ski. We actually do have snow, some winters more than others, but we have absolutely no mountains. But we apparently have mountains of trash. Because of the size of this power plant, we can actually, Isabel is the closest ski slope we can get to from Copenhagen. It's a few hours by car. We can put 2/3 of the main slope of Isabel on the roof of this building. So that's what we proposed. Imagine like a power plant that slopes continually. It has hiking paths, pine trees. Insanely, we won the competition based on this proposal. So suddenly we had to deliver. You probably remember that Denmark won 0 medals in Sochi. We hope to actually improve on those statistics. From 2017, we can actually practice at home. And it's not only for skiers. It's going to be a public park. You can hike, picnic, enjoy the views of the otherwise flat city of Copenhagen. It's going to have the tallest climbing wall in the world, 100 meters. And basically, you can say, like, the diagram you saw in the beginning, which is like a diagram trying to look at our cities and buildings as man-made ecosystems, is very close to becoming complete here, because not only do we harvest, you know, precipitation, the water that falls on the building for the park, natural daylight, natural airflows, but also together with the city of Copenhagen, it forms a sort of metabolism that returns the waste as a resource. These buildings are like, these pictures are 1 year old. But just to give you an idea, here I'm standing a third up on the hill. So this is not going to be like standing on the roof of a building. It's really going to be like standing on the side of a mountain, a more recent photo. So maybe just to sort of explain how we could sort of win a competition with such an unlikely proposal. It's basically because this is the cleanest waste-to-energy power plant in the world. The smoke that comes out of the chimney is completely non-toxic. So that's like an amazing aspect of green technology. Normally, you would want to be as far away as possible as you can be from a power plant because it's bad for you. Like here, you literally have clean mountain air on the roof of this building. And by making the building in this way, you don't have to like print all kinds of pamphlets and run ad campaigns to explain what's different about this kind of clean technology, because it's blatantly obvious that this is a whole new paradigm, and it sort of opens whole new avenues of thinking about public utilities where they can actually come with positive social and environmental side effects. To hammer this point completely home, we worked on the chimney. And we came up with the idea that the chimney could gradually accumulate steam, and then at regular intervals, it could puff a gigantic steam ring. So almost like changing the chimney from a symbol of all of our failures, all the things that seep out into the atmosphere, it could become a celebration that every time we've reduced the emission of one ton of CO2 by replacing the former power plant, we celebrate it by puffing a gigantic smoke ring. Maybe just sort of, because this idea has been sort of escalating a little bit for us. And 6 years ago, I went to New York because we got invited to do a building on the waterfront of Manhattan. And we came up with the idea that it could be maybe like a hybrid between the density and the individual qualities and views of a skyscraper, but with the communal and social qualities of a Danish courtyard, or essentially what could a court scraper look like. So we placed the courtyard building on the waterfront of Manhattan, then we had to give it Manhattan density, so we lifted up the northeast corner to 500 feet, but keeping the southwest corner open so you have like sun and views over the river. The result became this sort of striking silhouette that now sits on the waterfront of Manhattan and that sort of 2 days ago got awarded the best skyscraper in the world in the last 2 years. And basically when you see it, you can totally clap. No, basically when you see it from the water or from the outside, you suspect that this is probably just some kind of crazy gesture because it does have a kind of striking geometry. You'll notice that it has like this sort of warped pyramid shape. You have like terraces sunken into the roof. You have balconies looking out over the courtyard. The courtyard itself is actually, it has the same proportions as Central Park, only it's 13,000 times smaller. This sort of like miniature Central Park. And we took sort of put all of the communal programs and wrapped them around the central courtyard. And the courtyard really becomes almost like this sort of little sanctuary in the middle of the city, like a small piece of Copenhagen that has now sort of invaded the waterfront of Manhattan. But basically, the courtyard is not, even though you discover it as a surprise as you enter the building, the courtyard is the entire reason why the building looks the way it does. The fact that, you know, in one corner, it's the height of the handrail. On the other side, it's the height of a high-rise. So also, it really has a quite strong presence on the west side. This is the view when you land in Newark, a view that makes the architect very happy when he comes home. You can't talk about New York without also talking about Aarhus. And I must say that over the last couple of years, Aarhus has really become you know, our main playground in Denmark. A few years ago, we teamed up with a group of local sort of entrepreneurs, including Rune Kilden, who's sort of a very sort of active citizen of Aarhus, to make a bid on making this island number 4, the last remaining island in the harbor, and basin number 7. And we came up with this idea because, I mean, this is something that happens in all cities. The industrial port turns, you know, some of the functions move away and it becomes city. And what has happened everywhere and a lot in Copenhagen is that you just built some office buildings or you built some apartment buildings. There's no real life. The space around them is like left over or it's like becomes like mildly privatized. So what we tried here was to come up with an idea, and we suggested this to the city of Aarhus, that we would design all of the public space and all the public functions first, and we would build them first, and then the buildings would come later. And we presented this idea without having a fixed design, and then together with the city of Aarhus, we came up with a plan. And one of them was, instead of always having these like endless crane tracks of quays, we would actually create this sort of undulating promenade that would sort of invade, go deep into land and go deep into the harbor and back again. And we would use this promenade to sort of organize all of the public programs. So we would have the new harbor bath that's being built in Aarhus. We would set up a string of pearls of little like restaurants and cafes that would mean that you would actually walk, you'll be able to like walk all the way out, also like sheltered a little bit from the wind before the buildings come. There'd be a theater, and finally these bathhouses that people can buy or rent to have like a little outpost in the middle of the port. And then the buildings would come afterwards, and the building footprints, instead of the buildings shaping the urban space, the urban space actually shapes the buildings. We also lower the buildings so that we ensure that daylight comes to everywhere. And then actually to ensure the public nature of the urban realm, we made sure that all of the buildings have a private courtyard space, because the beauty, like sometimes in the idea that everything has to be public, then suddenly you start privatizing the public space by actually providing the homes with their little courtyards. We can ensure that the public realm becomes really public. So basically, this is sort of the general DNA, like all of the space around the little pavilions, the harbor bath extending into the port. And then only two of the buildings become bigger than the others. It's the one closest to the harbor, the active port, where we use the volume of the building to protect the rest of the neighborhood from the noise from the active port. And then finally towards the train tracks and the cars, again, a taller building to protect the neighborhood from the noise. And then basically this was our idea. You can see we didn't really design the buildings yet, but we designed it, designed everything between them. And it's actually sort of happening right now. We designed the harbor bath. You can see like a series of pools, a big wooden floating deck, a wooden promenade that is actually fully public. So you can walk around, walk out in the middle of the port. You have the diving pool where the divers and the people promenading will be at roughly the same height, say hello to each other. A big sort of lap pool. And then a series of thermal baths underneath this elevated promenade where you can sit and chill and enjoy the view of the port from your sauna. Sit in the cozy warmth and look out at the freezing birds. The promenade remains public throughout the day. We also have a small beach, recreating the beach bar that has been there in the last couple of years, but this time floating in the port. It's under construction. they are working hard to figure out how to put it together. And in addition, you know, then like there's a series of like little pavilions that make sure that as you walk out, there'll be like restaurants and liveliness. The last sort of curl on the tail of the harbor bath becomes the theater that sort of opened up towards the water. This sort of David Lynch-esque atmosphere looking out over the city. And then finally, of course, at the end of the pier, Aarhus, the first building that we're building, that in a way like a sort of a Danish twin of some of the ideas we developed in New York, we came up with this idea of, you know, making sure that we have a series of different houses, canal houses that actually sit with their feet in the water towards the canal and three, a series of like special sort of maritime related homes that actually open up to the pier, and finally the apartments with the terraces on top, creating this sort of, here you have the bath houses that are these little like sort of almost like allotment homes overlooking the water. And essentially we try to sort of really create this this building that almost feels at home in the port. Here you see this sort of almost like Vietnamese rice field landscape of large terraces, the communal courtyard that actually peaks out in the corner and looks out over the promenade. So and actually sort of we're trying to sort of continue these principles. We together with Rune Kilden and Slet, a local like really talented Aarhus architect, we've put in a proposal of how to maybe complete this master plan. But essentially again this idea of trying to take these sort of converted industrial areas and turn them into the framework of the cultural life of today. So from Aarhus, there's only one logical place to conclude, that's back in New York. I moved to New York 6 years ago to create the quartz scraper. And after I'd been there for like 2 or 3 years, Hurricane Sandy came and wiped out all of Lower Manhattan. And according to a cartoonist from The New Yorker, it gave rise to a whole new neighborhood in New York. But basically, after Sandy, everybody was sort of anxious to not have it happen again. So we got invited by the city of New York to look at how we could do all of the necessary flood protection for Manhattan in such a way that it wouldn't become a seawall that would segregate the life of the city from the water around it. And we looked at the High Line, and the High Line is really the most popular park in New York, only superseded by Central Park. And it is basically former train tracks that have now been given, you know, environmental and social programs. So we thought, what if we can actually design all of the necessary resiliency infrastructure, all of the necessary flood protection for Manhattan in such a way that we don't have to wait until it shuts down before it becomes nice? What if we could actually design it from the beginning with positive premeditated social and environmental side effects? And when you look at New York, it has very much been shaped by the clash of these two giants. On one hand, it's Robert Moses. He was also known as the power broker. He was a very, very powerful public servant. He created a lot of the big public works of New York, most of the highways, most of the public parks, most of the public housing projects. Like necessary projects, but often with a devastating impact on the local community. At some point, he tried to run the Trans-Manhattan Highway through Greenwich Village, and he encountered resistance from Jane Jacobs, who was living in the village, and she rallied the whole local community, and in a sort of David Goliath moment, she defeated the plans and saved the village. So we thought, what if the dry line, as we've called this project to protect Manhattan or keep Manhattan dry, the next time a Sandy comes, what if the dry line could be conceived as the love child of Robert Moses and Jane Jacobs? Because to resist an incoming flood, you need 10 miles of sort of coordinated hard engineering, but to make it socially successful, it needs to happen in a close dialogue with you know, the communities that actually inhabit the waterfront. So we presented a strategy to the city of New York, similar to the one we developed with Aarhus for Ö4, that we wouldn't give them a final proposal, but we would actually, we identified who are we gonna work with and how are we gonna use their feedback to actually create the necessary flood protection for Manhattan. So I'd like to finish by showing you a film we've made where you can see the different people from the communities that we worked with. You can hear their experience from Sandy, and you can hear their concerns and their dreams for their future waterfront, and see what it will look like.
That was actually why Sandy was so bad, is because of the phase of the moon, it was already a very large high tide, as well as the storm surge coming in with the wind and the tide lining up perfectly to give us 14-foot tides instead of 8-foot.
The most shocking part of Hurricane Sandy was the fact that it exceeded expectations.
I think the sheer magnitude of it caught a lot of people off guard.
When Hurricane Sandy came, we were not prepared at all. I mean, not even the slightest.
Yeah, it was like an alien invasion of water. And not the good kind of water.
So yeah, I mean, it came right in front. You know, there's literally boats on 14th Street floating in front of our window.
We had a sub-basement level office a block from here. And it was totally covered in water for 2 days. So we lost everything. Everything.
We're really concerned about another storm and the flooding that's possible, and we think that the next time it's going to come even further inland.
I'd like to see some type of flood protection in this area. That's going to happen. More vulnerable, obviously, being this close to the water.
Something that just brings like more walks, different walks of life, you know, another escape from just the busyness and the hustle and bustle.
There's this great space that could really become community space, cultural space, and active uses.
Everyone enjoys space. And in New York and other congested cities, it's hard to come by.
Anything that makes the cities greener is just such a wonderful thing for not only the environment, but the people that live in the city too, to be able to be around that space.
The plans, the berming, the sense of how it can become into the natural landscape itself, how we want to program that is really the next challenge. We are the link, we're the tip in the sense of the big U. It's important that the entire waterfront of Lower Manhattan build in the plans that have been put forward, because we can not only fortify this great city of New York, but be a model for cities all over the world.
So we're actually right now designing the first two-thirds of the Big U, this idea of an enhanced and improved waterfront that will be the same waterfront that actually keeps the city dry the next time a Sandy comes. And I think it's maybe a good place to sort of maybe return to this idea of the power of ideas. Because you can say as a... like normally you say that in naturally emerging leadership in a group, any group, happens with the one in the group who manages better than anyone else to capture the accumulated concerns and aspirations and dreams and desires of everybody in the group. And people sort of gather around this vision. And you can say as an architect, we can't say that we're going to make, a billion-dollar power plant with a ski slope on the roof. We have to wait until someone actually wants to make a power plant or needs to have a power plant, and then we can sort of, seize that necessity. We have to wait until someone says that we have to protect Manhattan from the next Sandy, and then we can sort of seize that utility and that necessity and use it as a vehicle to sort of advance some of our more ideological programs. So you can say, like, and that's maybe where the power of idea comes in, and then that's maybe where the idea of social infrastructure is interesting, maybe beyond the realm of architecture and city building, is that I think there's a lot of power in harnessing the power of the aspects of life or society that is use the practical and use it as a vehicle for the let's say the ideological and use take harness the power of the necessity and the things that have to be done and use it as a vehicle for all of the things that would be wonderful to create and that we actually dream about.
Well, thank you very much, Bjarke. I think he just illustrated why he is the man building the future. It's very impressive. Although it's a tough crowd. I mean, they didn't even applaud your skyscraper winning. So
yeah, I tell you what.
Let's see what kind of mean questions they can come up with. I still have to say, we have 30 minutes of Q&A now, so you can still ask questions to Bjarke either by raising a hand or by going to slido.com, where you can also vote on the questions that's already been asked. But I think we should just jump right into it. The favorite question, so to speak, right now is this one. Do you believe that modern architecture is killing national identity? Everything is made from glass and steel. How do we empower national identity? What's your thought on that?
I do think that, I mean, obviously there has been a great tendency, also when I started studying architecture, everybody would ask me when they heard, you're studying architecture, like, can you explain why are all modern buildings so boring? Whereas, when you look at some of the structures that have been preserved from the past, they have all kinds of ornaments, and like the old skyscrapers in New York, they have gargoyles that spew out the water and stuff. So of course, in that context, and also like modernism came with this idea of modern engineering, that where we used to rely on the windows for daylight, suddenly we have electric lights, so we didn't really need the windows so much. We used to rely on the thickness of the walls to keep a comfortable temperature, but now we had central heating and air conditioning. We used to rely on openings to get ventilation. Now we could actually have mechanical ventilation. So suddenly the architecture didn't do what it used to do, and it ended up just becoming like a boring container of space with a gas-guzzling machine room full of machines that would keep it alive. And that did result in buildings starting to look the same everywhere. And I think, in a way, what we're trying to do is that, and that's why they called modernism the international style, because building really did look the same everywhere. So I think what we're trying to do is, and I hope you can see from the projects we're doing, is that by not having this sort of universal answer that fits everything, but by insisting that in each and every case, there is a unique set of ingredients, there is a unique set of problems that need to be solved, there's a unique set of potentials that you can unfold, there is a unique climate, a unique culture, and using those elements, we use those elements as the driving force of the design, and that's why buildings start looking different, not just for fun, or for the sake of looking different, but because they perform differently in each and every case.
But you could argue that maybe some of the things that you're doing, that you're showing us, looks a little bit the same. I mean, your skyscraper has the courtyard center. You're planning on doing the same with the building here in Aarhus. I mean, that's not very Aarhus identical than if it's the same as the one in Manhattan, is it?
No, but I think they have each their thing. But actually, like, if we want to look at it like that, then, like, you know, most buildings have red brick in all of Europe, right? So that's not very unique. So in that sense, I think it's more about seizing. Cause, I mean, I think, you know, actually at some point, Wolf Morgenthaler, they invited me to babysit the Wolf Morgenthaler strip because they went on holiday over the summer. So I took the chance
and
to make...
And you didn't have anything else to do, so why
yeah,
not?
Yeah, I didn't have anything else to do. I always wanted to be a cartoonist. So then I actually decided to, you know, abuse my power and only make strips about architecture. And one of them that I did was, you know, like two images next to each other. One was just, one was called Copenhagen, and you see like a series of five-story buildings, and then you have, you know, Vafalsa Kirketorn with the spiral, and you have the Stock Exchange with the dragons, and you had like all the different spires, the round tower with the observatory at the top. And then the other one was like the same five-story buildings and nothing else, saying Copenhagen if everybody followed the rules. Because at the end of the day, identity is just as much about what brings us together. It's actually also very much about all the exceptions. And I think the landmarks in any city that makes you feel that you are in Copenhagen or that you are in Aarhus are often the exceptions to the rule rather than the rule itself. And I think, therefore, it is important for a city to have both. And I think identity is it's never a done deal, because like, your identity is only fixed when you're dead. If you are alive, and any city is alive, its identity will always transform. And when you think about some of the things that people are really proud of in Aarhus, it's, for instance, the rainbow halo of Olafur Eliasson on Aarhus. And 10 years ago, it wasn't here. And wouldn't it be depressing if Aarhus didn't have that today, just because everything had to fit in with a mold that was established before most people here were born?
But it brings me to think about something that you just said, that you said power is essentially about having the visions. I mean, at least when you're talking architecture, and visions, being able to think out something new and unique. Are you ever afraid that you will lose your ability to be visionary, because that would mean a loss of power?
I mean, it's funny. I mean, I think it solves itself, because I think what happens also like you know, when I started my company 16 years ago, there was like a huge disconnect between all the things that you know, I could do with if anyone would let me, and what people would actually let me do, right? So and I think the way that you navigate this is that as certain things happen for you, you get satiated with, like, certain appetites actually gets fulfilled or satiated. And it actually leaves room for craving for something else, and I think as long as you have that craving, as long as you don't, you know, endlessly repeat something because it was an early success, I think, you know, I'm not afraid of being stuck in that, because there's always this appetite to take it one step further. And I think maybe one thing that's important, if you look at the relationship between the New York building and the Aarhus building, I would say arguably they are like really sort of materially different, but clearly they are related. You can say that the New York building is almost like the American uncle of the sort of Aarhus nephew. And in a way, actually what happened when we were building the New York building, before we had the warped roof that makes it like so sharp and smooth, we actually had the floors, and we were looking at it and we thought, like, fuck, maybe we should have just left it with these terraces, like rice fields. That looks amazing. And then happily we got the chance to realize that dream. And that, in that sense, every idea you put forward has spin-offs that actually gives birth to new ideas that are maybe not entirely different, but they're like a distant cousin or some kind of a nephew of what came before.
So it's essentially it's about staying hungry, which I think, I mean, a lot of the participants here are asking this question. Is creativity, is that taught, or is it one born with it? I mean, did you just arrive to this world always hungry for new things, or did they teach it to you at school? Or?
Yeah, I mean, I think at the end of the day, but this is more like sort of a basic human belief. I mean, I have a little brother who's 11 years younger than me, and I have a big sister. But I was at the birth of my little brother, so I was standing in the birth room watching my little brother appear.
Very scary.
Exactly, and I was the first guy to hold him, and I brought him up to my mom, and it was clear to me that he already had the personality that he has, you know, from day one, from like the first second, and I think so. In that sense, I think what you are born with, the nature that you are born with, is your truth, and the nurture you get, and the education you get, the cultivation you get, is what enables you to express that truth as clearly or not as you can. So in that sense, I think what you have to offer the world, you're born with, but the extent to which you get to express it clearly is up for you know, your parents and your society to enable or inhibit.
But what would be your advice then for someone in here maybe wanting to fulfill their great potential? I mean, did you do anything yourself? You say it's about the surrounding society, but you must have done something yourself.
Yeah, I mean, this becomes like it sounds almost like cliches, but I mean, I think one of them is, you know, I started on the architecture school a little bit by accident because I wanted to be a cartoonist. That's why the Wolf Morgenthaler thing was very important. And it was because I didn't have a better plan, and it you know, it was the art academy. I would definitely
draw.
Yeah, you know, I'd drawn people and horses and helicopters and cars exploding or whatever, but I never drew buildings or landscapes. So I thought, you know, I'll spend a few years like getting good at drawing the backgrounds, and then I can focus on the foreground again. But then I got obsessed with architecture in the process. But I think in the beginning it was very frustrating, and it was because. I think in a way I was trying to because I didn't have any kind of premeditated ideas about architecture. Everything seemed so alien, and it was kind of people that know architects, it can be a quite uniform culture, and you know, like a very specific type. It's not like I'm completely changing the black wardrobe of architects myself. But in a way, like I think the moments where I was like getting in the wrong direction, when I was like too much trying to assume what I assumed to be the mindset of how you make architecture, and I think when the breakthroughs I had was when I reconciled my architecture personality with my own personality, instead of like putting on. The hat of being, now I'm an architect, now I think like an architect. It's like if I would remain the same person in my work as I am in my personal life, it was much more powerful because it was much more true, and what came out was much more exciting. And I think it's when you try to behave the way and to think the way that you assume is the norm, then maybe it starts becoming predictable and uninteresting, and also uninteresting for yourself.
Okay. A question here says, what project or building have made you feel the most powerful? I'm assuming it's one that you built.
I mean, I must say, lately I walked on the roof of Amager Bakke, or the powder plant, as Wired magazine called it. And my concern was a little bit, because at the end of the day, we put a ski slope on the roof of a building. But when you walk up that that hill, it really feels like standing on the side of a mountain, and there's no fear that this is not like a real ski slope. It is. It's like a piece of Danish bedrock that we have created from scratch. And that that felt pretty epic.
Hell yeah, I built a mountain. What's your approach to leadership? As I said in the introduction, you now have a company of around 250 employees. Do you consider yourself a leader? I mean, or does the creative person always wins?
But I would say like for sure, and I think maybe two aspects to that question. First of all, I think leadership, one of the most important aspects of leadership is that you actually set the tone of your company. So just like, you know, children learn how, they don't do what their parents say, they do what their parents do. And I think it's the same in a company that, you know, people behave the way that their leadership behaves. And in that sense, you as a leader, you have an amazing power to set a tone and a way of working together that is either gonna create a wonderful workplace or it can create like a terrible environment. And before I started my own company, I was working for my favorite architect, a man called Rem Koolhaas, who still is my favorite architect. But the work environment was simply non-conducive to my personal happiness. So I decided, also I felt like I could do it myself, but also I really was conscious about making sure that I end up creating the place where I want to work myself. So that's one thing, like maybe this idea of setting the tone or setting the example. And then I think secondly, big, and also I'm not the CEO of Big, I'm sort of the creative director. So we have a sober, reliable businesswoman.
A woman, yeah, Sheila,
in charge of our company. So I'm like the creative leader, and it's the way we make decisions and the way we design our buildings is not it's not a democracy because we never vote, and it's not a dictatorship because it's not just because I say so. It is a meritocracy, if you like, in the sense that the ideas that merit the most are the ideas that we end up pursuing. And you can say, it's not necessarily my job to come up with the best idea or the most brilliant idea, although I love it when I actually come up with it. But it's my job to make sure that it's the greatest idea that we end up pursuing and that it ends up getting built. And I think in that sense, our process is so much about constantly reiterating what are the design criteria that we're dealing with, what is the biggest problem we have to solve, what is the greatest potential we can unfold. And by constantly reiterating that, almost like by constantly narrating the design as we go along, we constantly fine-tune the logic behind what we're doing. And we constantly fine-tune it so that not only I, but everybody on the team, and actually all of our consultants, and even our collaborators and the clients, are empowered with the knowledge of why it is we're doing what we're doing. So in that sense, at the end of the day, the more refined the logic of what we do is refined, the more people on their own are capable and empowered to proactively propose things because they know what we're going for. It's not just like a lot of executive morons waiting for the leader to say something, because like at the end we're all experts of the project because we constantly reiterate what it's all about.
So that's your take on how to empower others?
Yeah, for sure with information, and because I think maybe in some fields there's a certain fear that if you're too great of the teacher, then eventually the student is gonna surpass the master. But you know, it's obviously more fun to work with the Jedi's than it is to work with Padawans.
It totally lost me. I'm sorry. I never watched the movies. I'm hoping someone else got it. Actually, let's just jump in right into the next question. That's a bit different, but it's fun. Would you design Trump's Mexico wall, and if so, how would it look?
I don't think that wall is ever going to happen. I hope it's never going to happen. And I hope that he's not going to be the president of the United States.
Okay. But do you ever, I mean, do you ever have jobs, tasks that you actually have a hard time taking on? But, I mean, you have to get some money in the bank by the end of the day.
Yeah, but I mean, I think at the end of the day, you know, I think we're pretty fortunate on that aspect. So there's also actually two answers to that question. Because, I mean, we have said no a few times. But it was mostly, you know, like at some point we were actually doing a photovoltaic laboratory in Korea. And then because of like some fluctuations in the market, the same corporation turned it into a place where they would do the robot guidance for missiles. And then we said, you know, we're not going to make an arms factory. And they were like completely fine. So we get it. You're excused. And then, of course, we have in the past worked for, you know, we won the competition to design the National Library of Kazakhstan, which is not like the most celebrated democracy on the planet. But there my thinking was that at the end of the day, are we making a positive impact with this project? Will the citizens of Kazakhstan be better off by having you know, an amazing public library, you know, only the way that we could do it? And my answer to that question was this, and therefore I said we're totally going to do it, and we're going to give them the most amazing national library they've ever seen. And actually, like, I was also thinking about like a lot of the buildings and the institutions that are the foundation of Danish democracy, which is essentially what's called the indskrænket monarki, a limited monarchy, were actually built by kings. And then eventually they informed the public so much that they became so well educated that eventually they asked for the power, and the king voluntarily gave it over with a little bit of pressure. But that's why we still have a king, and that's why actually I love the idea of kingdoms. It's just like all the kingdoms are the ones where the ruler gave up power freely, and the ones that don't are the ones where they had to cut his head off before he would surrender. So that was my thinking. What we came to as a conclusion was that it's simply impossible to act in certain places, and eventually we were like asked for bribes all the time. In every time you were alone, you almost had to try to not be alone in the room with anyone from the president's office, because as soon as the door closed, they started asking for money, and it's like, you know, we can't do it. We can't do it. And eventually, we lost the job to another contractor. So, but I think I wouldn't design Trump's wall for specific reasons. But I do think that it is important that not just the little cultural gems like the concert halls and you know the universities deserve architecture. It should also be you know the factories and the highways and the train stations and like the industrials, the power plants, the places where we deal with our trash and the sort of the back of house of our cities. They also deserve architecture, and there's a huge potential in actually taking those resources and also getting the maximum out of them.
That actually leads to another question I think we should just take. As power comes along with the responsibility, in addition to fancy architecture, what's your take on building, you know, new living space, for example, the socially unadvantaged? I mean, you did your student buildings, but I heard that some of the apartments in the Aarhus building is sold for, I mean, lots and lots of millions already. So how do you honor that the responsibility that comes with your job?
No, but I think we again, like, because we do, like, for example, like the Via, the warped pyramid on the Manhattan skyline, 20% of the homes are affordable, so they're like you can get a studio in.
Do you put that in as a demand when you're doing the building?
No, this was the city, and I think in general, you know, I can't tell a client, you know, like, you should not make money on this project. What I can do is try to make it as in a way as successful as possible on all metrics. And I think like the student housing urban rigor, if Aarhus has any available water area, urban rigor should definitely help you with your student home issues. Actually, the two projects apart from the power plant, it's the absurdity of our situation. Like the three projects we're doing in Copenhagen is a power plant that turns trash into electricity. It's social housing in Nordvest, and it's student houses on the train tracks. So in that sense, we are almost exclusively working with the projects that are never architecture. And of course, there's a huge potential. It's a little bit harder when you have less resources to make something out of the ordinary. But if you can do it, the impact is going to be so much greater.
Okay.
And I also think we're like with the power plant, we are raising the bar, because you would have you'll have a harder time arguing for doing just a big crappy power plant in the future if you can point at Copenhagen and say, well, in Copenhagen they ski on their power plants. You know, why is this just a dumb box?
True. But you actually said a couple of times during your presentation that you may have power, but you don't have political power. You don't have the decisive power in the end. Is that ever frustrating? I mean, sitting there with all your drawings and your sketches and, you know, knowing this could be great, this could be, I would win a new award for this, and then you get, I mean, someone else get picked instead. Isn't that frustrating?
It's terrible. I also like to, I mean, we lose so many competitions, and it is a disaster, actually. But you know, in a way,
how do you keep up the spirits and I mean, with your employees, when they've spent so many hours?
It's like the Energizer Bunny, like the Duracell Canine. You just have to keep going. Or like the sort of tumble cup for babies that just keeps getting up every guy in time and gets knocked over. No, but I think it's such a slow profession, architecture. You know, like the building we did on the west side, it's taken 7 years, and everything has been like maximum speed. So therefore, in the process, you're working on so many projects at the same time, and they move at different speeds. So you just have to say, you know, damn it, and then focus on the next thing. And then maybe some of the DNA that the thoughts, the ideas that were developed, can maybe resurrect in another form in another project. And I think maybe it's a good. I think maybe this probably also transcends architecture. That's why also we never make a project with the purpose of winning. So we'll never make a choice, sort of, yeah, but if we do this, we'll probably win. Like, it's more like sort of, what is the most amazing thing we can do here? Of course, it has to be fully realistic, and we have to know that we can deliver it. But, you know, what would be the most game-changing thing to do in this case? And that's what we pursue. Because if you make all these like tactical compromises, then if you win, you're stuck in the next 5 years building it. Maybe not, you know, it's gonna be 5 years where you could have done something else, something more, you know, elevating. And if you lose, then you really lose, because then you did like a shitty tactical sort of compromise, and you didn't even win, so you didn't even develop anything interesting. Whereas if you do something amazing, if you win, you'll get to build it, and if you lose, at least you did something amazing.
So you have to live with it for a long time. this question, I think, is also really interesting. What kind of considerations did you have in designing this new World Trade Center, the last one of the new towers, considering how sensitive a subject 9/11 is?
Yeah, I mean, of course, that was like a very daunting. There's actually an interesting little curl to this story, because like in Kazakhstan, after 2 years, we finished the foundations. We were above ground. We had had like 10 people in Kazakhstan for like a year. It was a complete nightmare. It's minus 40 degrees in the winter, plus 40 in the summer. Then this other contractor comes in and says, we're going to do this building with Norman Foster as the architect, and we're going to put it on your foundations. And somehow there was a deal made, and the president's office says, yes. So then when we came to the World Trade Center, Norman Foster had already designed a building for that site, and he had finished the foundations, and we got to put our building on top. And it just felt like poetic justice. But apart from that, actually, when I started my office in 2001, we won our first competition at the end of August. So we were busy painting our first office space on September 11. And of course, like saw the towers. We saw the second plane hit, and we realized it was terrorism. And then you realized that they actually collapsed. And of course, I never thought for a second that we would ever be involved in building one of the towers. But so when it happened, also it happened like, what is it, like 13 years after the event. So we were quite clear that they had already opened the memorial. And in a way, the memorial was, it's like an 8-acre park where the city commemorates what happened at 9/11. And there's the footprints of the two towers with the big fountains. There's the memorial center. There's a beautiful park. That's where we remember what happened. And then in a way, the four towers that frame the memorial, where ours is going to be the second one, that's where the city soldiers on, and New York is a lively, living city that keeps being a lively and living city. So in that sense, we in a way deliberately took the memorial aspect out of our building and said, that's here, but what we have to do is become the dignified frame that frames the memorial. But then an interesting thing happened. So we were tailoring it for like this media headquarters. So there was studios and newsrooms and sort of editorial floors and sort of more classic towers. So because of the wedge shape of the site, the lower levels are like very long and slender, and then they get shorter and wider. So from one side it actually becomes bigger towards the top, and the other side it actually becomes more like a gigantic stair with huge parks as you go up. And then after we announced it, I got a letter a few days later from a man who was like, dear Mr. Ingalls, my brother was one of the first responders that gave his life at 9/11 with this engine company. I just want to tell you that I really like your design, the new design for the tower, because I see it as a giant stair to heaven, commemorating the heroic stair climb of the first responders and also the ascent to the heavens of the innocent souls that died in 9/11. So for him, he thought it was amazing that not only the ground, but actually the skyline of the city of New York would commemorate the heroism and sacrifice of 9/11. And I responded sort of, I thought it was like a beautiful sort of a symbolism that we had not thought about that at all. But now that he said so, now I also see it like that. And I think it's like, it's very typical for public art, which architecture is, because like buildings are outdoor, they really become part of the city and therefore they belong to everyone else. You know, of course, as architects, we put all of our ideas and our soul and our sort of dreams and intentions into it. But once we let go of it, then it becomes everybody else's, and their interpretation is as valid as mine. And in that sense, like now, of course, our tower is a staircase to heaven, just as much as it is all of the things we put into it.
Well, Bjarke, we're actually running out of time, but I would like you conclusively to give one advice, your best advice, whatever advice, if you can say whatever you want, but to the leaders of tomorrow, as Lars Løkke said, to our audience, what would be your best advice for them?
actually, my favorite quote from a philosopher, and maybe it's back to this idea, if it's something you're born with or if it's something you're taught. I think it's Schopenhauer. And it translates poorly into English, but the English translation is, you can do what you want, but you cannot will what you want. In Danish, it's more beautiful. It's man kan gøre hvad man vil, men man kan ikke ville hvad man vil. And I think the wisdom in it is that if you want something, you have the ability as a human being to act on it or not. I mean, of course, you might not succeed, but at least you have the ability to act on what you want or not. But what you can't is decide with your head what it is that you want, you know, with your heart. And I think in all aspects of life, if you become attentive to what it is that you really want, instead of deciding with your head, instead of willing what you want, to actually listen and really find out what it is you want, then you actually have the power to go ahead and do it. But as soon as you try imposing it with a head as an abstract idea, or because you heard it, or because you thought so, or because you thought that was what expected for you, then you're gonna end up in trouble, and you're gonna end up making it bad for yourself and everybody else. But if you stay true to the truth that you're born with, then that is an amazing power and an amazing driver to make a difference.
Okay, we'll think about that. Thank you very much, everyone. Good.
So thank you, Bjarke, for a very interesting and inspiring presentation and for engaging us in your creative work. We have a sign of our gratitude for you, and thank you so much for coming here today.
It's a optimist.
Yeah, the sign. Tak, Bjarke. And Vibeke, thank you for moderating this session. It is a great pleasure to have you back at our symposium.
It's always fun. Thank you.
So this marks the end of your first session today, and just for information, track 3 will have their next session in the Jyske Bank auditorium and track 4 in the TDC Group auditorium. So thank you so much for your engagement on Slido, and enjoy the break.